important, and the Indian elite understands that, I must give them credit for that, is that any mark of a great power is to be able to deliver common goods. That's what United States does. Its ability to give, provide common goods is what gives it the great power status. So if India is aspiring to be a great power, it needs to do that, and it needs to be partner with United States in doing. Okay? So, we have any time, or shall I wind up? It's about time.
You have another 5 minutes.
Five minutes, okay?
And we'll have questions.
So I just want to now come to two things, sort of talk more about the future, a little bit, for a few minutes, but also talk a little bit about the economy. I think many of you who are in business and banking and so on are probably keeping up with the Indian economy, so I don't need to tell you, but any of us who, most of us who go back every year, you know, and it looks, India is so vibrant. I mean, I went to Pune recently and I was amazed at the transformation in that sleepy little town as I knew it then, you know, at one time, or Hyderabad, or Bangalore, of course, is legendary as far as transformation is concerned, but even second towns, you know, have transformed themselves. So it is growing. It is growing at 9% recent. They're saying between 8.5 to 9% rate of growth. The internal, shall we say, structural push in India for the economic growth is definitely upwards. Whether it would correct and become 8 or 7, but the trajectory is, you know, going forward. There are, of course, lots of things that can, adverse things that can happen. Adverse things are anywhere from, you know, slow growth of economic infrastructure, new regulations that come in, and most important of all, the need, and I call it need, and I don't call it policy. Many people criticize policy, but I would say need on part of India to continuously balance growth versus welfare. This is not something that is a matter of choice. It is a matter of necessity. If India is to remain stable, it must continue to provide those who are now out there voting, and the largest number of poor in India vote anywhere in the world. The poor in this country don't vote in the kind of percentages that we are talking about. The poor in India go and vote, which means that whoever is in government needs to have, it's an imperative of the government to balance this kind of public expenditure, whether you call it loan guarantees or you call it unemployment programs, you know, for the rural poor, or you all kinds of things that are, you know, education, healthcare, insurance schemes for the poor. All these things are needed. They are not what you would call it, an expendable expenditure. This is a necessary expenditure, but that has to be balanced against growth. And this is an imperative that is difficult to do within a democratic structure. Now, this is not to take away from the problem of governance, and there are very serious problems of governance. We all know that. That is a sort of a euphemism to call it governance. What we call it is corruption. So, you know, the problem of corruption is the problem of governance. And those are so, you know, epic proportion. We all know about that scandal, surplus scandals, but that too is an important issue, and that has an impact on the perceptions about how outsiders see India, whether it's managing itself well or not. This is something one pays little attention to, take it for granted, because we do take a lot for granted. But as we know, it is the state governments that really call the shots on whole lot of economic agenda that the national government is trying to put together. So the state of Maharashtra will do something else, and state of Bihar will do something else, and state of Orissa will do something else, but they have the constitutional right to do and act or not act as they please on number of issues, or act wrongly if they so please, until such time as some kind of a corrective situation takes place. And since many of the state governments are governed by individual political parties, that owe no allegiance to the coalition government at the center. How you want to control that? So the whole structure of our federal government, the structure of federal democracy, you know, sort of goes against this business of saying, sitting somewhere and say, India should do this and India should do that and they should do this and they, you know, yeah, they should do all of that. But if it is to be done within the context, then of course we have to have a different assessment. So what I'm coming to this by saying this, that despite all these really genuine structural issues and international problems and the challenges that have come up as a very responsive public, a public that has high aspirations of what it wants, a vocal, articulate public, this is a very difficult thing to do, and they have done it. So a lot of people sort of castigate the coalition government, say, oh, there's all chaotic and nothing happens and so inefficient and so on. But if you really compare 1989 with today, you will see enormous, enormous transformation. And ask yourself, who has brought this transformation about? Not a Congress-dominated single system, but a coalition government. So the point is that we need to therefore reassess, we need to rethink. And what I'm suggesting to you is that this is a unique feature. So coming back to the fact that what are the models, India is a very distinctive model of development, which challenges the early models of development of industrialized countries, you know, which went and industrialized Europe and so on, or the East Asian countries, which had miraculous growth very quickly and rapidly. But India is a different path, and it is a path that ought not to be belittled simply because it happens to be strewn with all these other things that we are all aware of, you know, the weaknesses and the corruption and etc., etc. China is very corrupt too. I'm not trying to defend India, I'm just trying to think about it differently. What I'm trying to share with you is that there perhaps is a way of thinking about this, because the rise of India is a rise of this kind of politics and economics. And the rise of India is a particular kind of the rise of a model. And that is something that is being appreciated and made a partner into a larger international architecture that is coming into being in the post-Cold War era. I'm going to stop there. Thank you.